Welcome back to the Pro Series Podcast. This is episode 117, and today's guest is Taylor Rako from Taylor Rako Designs. She is an interior designer up in Vancouver, Canada. We talk all about interior design, school for interior design, and so much more. But before we get into this episode, please like, subscribe, and review this podcast on wherever you listen to podcasts. And I hope you enjoy episode 117 with Taylor Rako.
Awesome. Taylor, thank you so much for hopping on the Pro Series once again. The first time didn't go as planned when we had recording issues with my last recording company software system that you, whatever you want to call it, I switched back over to Zoom. So glad to have you back on.
I'm so happy to be here. So thank you. I know it's like a busy time, you know, like we're coming towards that holiday season. So yeah. I'm excited to relive a new convo with you. Hopefully my headpieces are okay.
Sounds good on my end.
Good.
And I think I was trying to think back when we first talked. Was it back in September or was it August?
Oh, no. It had to have been in the summer. It had to have been.
Really?
I feel like it was in the... Oh, was it in September?
I don't know. Time just doesn't make sense to me right now. So I don't know.
No, it's... I feel like our industry right now, it's kind of coming to that crunch time where... You know, the holidays is like, I know like in Canada, like our holidays are kind of spread out. We have Thanksgiving in September, but in the States, I know you guys have like, it's literally Thanksgiving and then Christmas. So it's like bamba, right?
Yeah. Thanksgiving's next week. And then a month later is Christmas.
That's so wild. And so, yeah, everyone's like, I want to get everything in. I want my furniture in. So it's like a big push.
Yeah. Well, you gave a little bit away to the followers that you are a designer, but let's get into that. Where did it all start? How did it all start? Were you always a design mind person, creative? Like, how did that all start?
Yeah, you know what? Like, I've always really gravitated towards like blocks as a kid. And I didn't, you know, this is before, obviously, Instagram and TikTok and just like being very virtual in general. So, you know, I just always liked doing things with my hands, and I tried to steer into the direction of that very general, like I would say like that very sciencey industry where at the time it just felt a little bit more of like a solid place to be in terms of like career wise.
Oh yeah.
So I tried to do that and I didn't really like it. And then, you know what? I was just like, let's just jump on with TikTok, Instagram, and just start with having fun with it.
Yeah.
I feel like it's really important. And here we are now.
And you went to school for design, right?
I did. Okay.
And that's when you started your TikToks and social media. Did you brand it yourself or was it just generally just a regular interior design page?
To be honest, I worked in like before I went to school, I did a lot of event planning. So I knew that I really liked the like putting things from my brain into fruition in real life.
Yeah.
But after that, I was like, oh, you know, it's just like I need something more permanent. Like I felt like for events for me, although it's so fun, if I'm going to put so much time into making something look as magnificent as like the client wants it to be, then it would be amazing if it could be more like long lasting, you know? So that's why I took a leap and I went back to school for interior design because my undergrad was in sociology. Mm-hmm. And I loved it. And basically to go into your question about how did you brand yourself? At the time in school, a lot of the designers are just starting an Instagram account. Mm-hmm. And they have, you know, it's really just to post what you're doing in school. And it's just like a fun thing.
Yeah.
But at the time COVID had hit and immediately like school started to shut down, you know, the whole drill, we all are aware.
Mm-hmm.
And I got my first client from my Instagram account.
While you were in school?
Yes, while I was in school.
Wow.
Yeah. And so that was like basically the first start. And, you know, of course, like while you're taking on projects when you're in school, you know, it's our responsibility to make sure that we're not biting off more than we can chew,
yeah.
Right? We got to be able to, if we're going to say we're going to do something, we need to be well equipped with the knowledge to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously like the confidence, because we're the leaders in the project, right? Mm-hmm. So that was my first real taste of it. And I guess like, I just never really looked back. I was just continued to do my thing on social, and here we are. I met you. Yeah. So it's cool.
Yeah. That's the best thing about social media. You can meet everybody. But the cool yeah. thing is that you did start that. Was that encouraged to start the social media in school, or was it just kind of like something that everybody did?
To be honest, like I feel like school and social, they kind of came hand in hand in a way, because I don't know about other designers, but for me, when I was starting to get that interest of getting into the design industry, Instagram was what kind of was filling up my explore page.
Yeah.
You know, it was Instagram was filling up my explore page with a bunch of design inspiration and projects. So in my mind, I kind of saw it making sense. I'm like, oh, I mean, Instagram isn't a stranger to posting design content, so why not do something for fun?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. But I think it's so smart. I've talked to so many, my school that I went to, I've come back as a professional and spoke about social media and how important it is. Because it's, I mean, yeah, you're probably not proud of a lot of the projects you do in school, because at least me looking back on it, I look at my projects and I'm like, ugh. But I'm so glad I started this after school, but I still posted a couple of projects, because it just shows growth and it shows the clients that you have grown. And I think that's huge.
Totally.
And I think it should be, I mean, I don't know about you, in my design school, we had a class on your personal brand. So you make your own logo and all that stuff, and you brand all your projects. Why
not
no
way.
On social media? Like,
wow.
That'd be awesome if that was encouraged in school, but it wasn't. But I do see more students doing it now.
Yeah, no, it's like school was just like, it's such an interesting concept for design, because I found that when I was looking to start my own company and go into it that way with Taylor Reiko Design, I started to kind of feel like a push and pull, because here I am in the middle of the pandemic with some clients that want help, but I guess systematically speaking in my head, my brain is being pulled to, well, like you need to finish this and you need to do this before you go here.
Yeah.
You know, like what makes you think that you can tell someone what size area rug that they should use if you haven't even finished school? Like that was like in my brain, that was like,
okay,
that was where it was. And after taking on the projects that I've had, I realized, you know, like when you're picking colors and stuff, like that is all so by the eye, you know. Of course there are elements where you gotta know how to use certain softwares, because that's a form of communication to the builders. But creatively speaking, it's never a linear process, right? Like if you were to ask me, oh, hey, like I have this, I bought new bedspreads and I would love it if you picked out like 3 throw pillows to put on my bed. Like, do you need a degree to pick out 3 throw pillows to put on a bed?
Mm-mm.
No, you know? So yeah. I feel like that was interesting for me, because I grew up thinking, no, you gotta get the highest level of education before you can even think to help anyone.
Yeah.
But you learn so much when you're working with clients too. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah, growing up and thinking about going to school for interior design, did you ever think of it being, I mean, I know most people that don't know or that haven't been in the interior design field think it is all throw pillows and curtains and all that stuff. And in reality, that's not it. That's interior
No.
grading. Did you struggle with going and saying that you're going to school for interior design or caring about what other people said about interior design because of what people thought in the world what interior design was?
No, you know what? I feel like I've struggled a lot with coming to terms with the fact that I wanted to do something creative, but
Okay.
we live in a world that makes people feel like anything artistic is like the ultimate failure of a job almost.
Yeah, like you're not
And
going to make a
so,
living. Yeah.
yeah. And when I decided for myself that I wanted to get into the design industry, I really could care less at that point. Like I've been through it. Like I've been through that roller coaster already where I was like, I'm so unhappy and I'm doing something that other people want me to do. You know,
Yeah.
like I'm trying to get into this program that other people want me to do.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Do you get that now though, like from other people trying to ask you for pick out paint colors or curtains or throw pillows and stuff, and do you find yourself explaining a lot to your friends and family or other people what interior design actually is?
You know what? Yeah, I would say there are a lot of people that would come to me and say like, "Oh, I want to do my kitchen." You know, like, what does that look like? Is that something you offer? Or, "Oh, I want to redo my like I want to furnish my whole house. Is that something you offer?" So, yes, Eric, I definitely did not divide these two well at the start, but interior design is, I would say, defined in my mind as something that's like very remodel construction base. It's
Yes.
like you're tearing out the drywall, you might be moving the sink from here to here, or just anything that requires builders or trades is deemed interior design. That's how I categorize interior design.
I like that.
Right? And then interior decorating, you can correct me what you think, but is the decorating, you know, it's you don't need a builder to put up a frame, and you don't need a builder to buy a couch and a side table. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, like, yeah, basically, to separate those two, that's like under the design umbrella, there's interior decorating, which is like the furniture and like the in the walls. And then I would say, or sorry, outside of the walls. And then interior design is more in the walls, if
Yeah.
that makes sense.
Yeah, structural. I had a
Yeah.
just last year say the way he explains it is if you take your house and turn it upside down and shake it, everything that falls out is not what I do. Everything that stays in is what I do, which is
Right.
kind of a cool way to
Oh, that's cool.
furniture will fall out, plants will fall out, pictures will fall
Right.
out, curtains will fall out, but the kitchen cabinets won't fall out. The layout of the room won't fall out. And that's kind of the way I've kind of changed the way I describe it. Because it is. I don't know how it is in Canada, but just HGTV, which I love HGTV, and I'm not downgrading HGTV at all. I love HGTV and everybody that's
Right.
on my podcast with it. It just, it's a TV show, so they have to do something to make it more, pleasing to others that aren't in the industry to watch it. So it's not their fault, but it's just how it's perceived nowadays.
Right. Yeah, no, for sure. It's yeah, I
What way do you think, while you think about this, I'll answer what I think, but what way could they change interior design as a name to make it more appropriate to what it is? I know a few schools here in my area are changing their program from interior design to interior architecture.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. And I thought that was a pretty interesting way to, because that is kind of what we do. I just don't know how architects feel about that.
Yeah, I feel like it's anything in the creative industry, it's not linear, you know? Like for me, like I feel like it's so broad. And I don't say this to offend or put down anyone's career, right? Because I feel like, you know, as long as everyone's doing what they're happy doing, like, and they stay in their lane, I think that's like amazing. Happy for everyone. But like I feel like there's always going to be some sort of understanding of what interior design is, right? Like I say I'm an interior designer, I do kitchens, bathrooms, new builds, and I also do furniture, you know? But for me, when I put it out there into the world, like I just call myself an interior designer. Because let's be honest, if I'm like, hey, Eric, I'm an interior designer slash interior decorator, and you want to know what that is X, Y, and Z. You know what I mean? It's like,
Yeah, I
it's a
think,
mouthful,
yeah, and I don't think
right?
the furnishing part of it downgrades what you say as an interior designer, because I think it's an add-on.
For
Because you're doing
sure.
the full job. And there's so many designers that will design a space and then leave it. So they're like, oh, how are you going to put the finishing touches? How am I, what fits
Yeah.
this room? What can I put here? So, I mean, it's just an add-on to you're already a service.
Yeah, I feel like, yeah, to tag on to what you mentioned, it's such a big, like, it's like a communication thing, you know, like it's our job to be able to communicate what we can do. And so I would say, you know, I'm an interior designer. And then people would ask, oh, but do you also do design, like the furniture decor? And I'd say, yes, like that's something I offer. But I do want to kind of like backtrack back to when I was talking about school, because I feel like this is very important for me to say is interior design, yes, like when you're working with anything with trades or the city, because every city has their own codes, or did I say builders already? Not yet. Yeah, builders. It is very important to have the necessity or have the necessary tools under your belt to be able to work with other professionals like in that area that is so invasive to someone's home. So I will say like for school, it is very important that you know, we don't go in blindfolded and think, oh, I'm just gonna do this, you know, like I don't really know what I'm doing, but you know, it's always important to have the skills that you need to lead a client. But going into like decor, which you know, I feel like we divided later on, you don't if you're trying to like find furniture that fits a space, you know, that is something that is, let's say, like, you know, it's a little bit more forgiving, right? If the client says that they don't like the way the chair fits, then you can always return it, right? There's really like little skin in the game on that. And so I feel like the thing that the two areas of expertise, interior design and interior decorator, have in common is just the communication piece. Like, are you well equipped to communicate the scope that the client wants? Does that make sense?
Yeah,
I'm not
that
sure.
makes total sense. Yeah, there's a
Okay.
big overlap in
Yeah.
decor, and it's almost like interior design and architecture. There's an overlap with those two as well, which there's a struggle between that as well with interior designers and architects as well. But if all work together, the job goes smooth.
For
So
sure.
it's just kind of like getting rid of that persona of what you think of those two professions or any bordering professions. Makes you better as a designer or better as an architect or a decorator, and puts you apart from the others.
Yeah, I guess so.
What's one thing you would change? Oh, wait, let's go back to this. I've talked to many people that I graduated with from design school, and they always complain about like they weren't prepared for the design world. And I always thought, like, that's not what college is really about. because you're going for a major that is very broad.
Right.
You could go into interior design and be kitchen and bath designer. You could work for a builder. You could work for commercial. What is your opinion on that? Do you think the same way, or do you think you just weren't prepared coming out of school?
You know, with, I actually, okay, so this is really interesting of a topic because I was talking with my two team members about this. But there are areas where school definitely prepares you, which is like teaching you the software systems, AutoCAD, SketchUp, Revit, right? Like all of those, like that foundation of having, of knowing how to communicate what's up here to you. But on the other hand, I feel like something that the school system could, or there's room for the school system to improve on, is giving designers sort of like that one-on-one experience as if they're talking to a client. Because I'm not sure how every school puts projects out for their students, but for us, the client is a piece of paper. The client is, you know, they're two people that live together that might have kids, might have dogs, and they have hobbies, right? And it's literally like they are a paragraph, right? Yeah. They're a paragraph. So as designers in school, we get to imagine what they would like. But here's the thing is, I feel like a very like fundamental part of being a designer is understanding how to take critiques and criticism from the client. But in school, it's hard to do that, you know? It's really hard to like emulate that experience, because there comes that level of composure that, you know, you need to have, and like that open-mindedness. It's not the same as the instructor to give the feedback. You know what I mean? I'm not sure if that, right?
I agree. Yeah. That'd be a cool, interesting way to change. I think a good way to change or add to it. I went to a school that had liberal study classes. So we had to take so many credits of liberal studies. It had nothing to do with what we were graduating with.
Right.
I think it would have been cool to have like behavioral study classes to like understand people.
Yes. Yes.
Because you're going to use that in any profession.
Mm-hmm.
But I would have rather done that than, you know, chemistry. Because chemistry, I mean, we
fair enough, yeah.
Way. Like if you're building a house down south and material wise, with the salt air and stuff, but you're learning chemistry as a chemist major. You're not learning it as an interior designer. So more classes that are more suited for the designer, I guess. I would.
Yeah, you know what? I never even thought of this until now, but I graduated with a sociology degree. And at the time I was like, oh, I don't really know what this is going to do. Like, I don't want to be a social worker. That doesn't sound fun to me.
Mm-hmm.
So then I was like, it's okay. Like, I got that experience of being in school for a different sort of like academic purpose. And then now I'm going to go do this. But yeah, it definitely helps to have that parallel, because anything, even if I actually encourage people to take maybe like one or two sociology classes.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, it's like the knowledge of people.
Yeah.
It's not psych, but it's kind of understanding like the energy in environments.
Yeah. Which,
so there's a parallel to that.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I'm glad my first job, and actually a couple other jobs after that, I learned the DISC system. Which is a behavioral studies type of system, and being able to read someone in 30 seconds, so you know how to treat them, because everybody wants to be treated differently.
For sure.
So I think that would have been so beneficial for literally anybody going through school, more than art history, some type of thing like that has nothing to do with your major at all, or you're not going to use in a profession after school.
Right. You know what? Like, I got to touch on that. Like, I feel like Because I felt like art history was actually helpful for me. Okay, here's the thing. It's really dry. Depending on, you know, it's dry because you're kind of going over like the same sort of thing. But as if you tape your eyes open and you really try and like pick out like those little like details, it can be very helpful. But I totally see what you're saying with like having some sort of like interactive course, you know, where like you're designing for a classmate and then you're, you know, so then you have like Bob and Sally, right? And they are designing for each other. So they have their own authentic opinions.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
And I think
that's interesting. That would work.
We had to take two art history classes for some reason at my school. First one was very beneficial. That's when you learn to read the art and figure out what was going on, the meaning behind it. And the second one, it was just, I think that's what really put a sour taste in my mouth, just because we had to write essays on the art pieces, and it had nothing to do with the creative outlook of looking at a painting and knowing what it symbolizes or something like that. So I mean,
write an essay?
Yeah, every
no
single
kidding.
You'd put a piece of art on the thing, and we had to write an essay.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's almost like, hey, yeah, no, that's almost. Oh, I don't know. Would you prefer to write an essay, right, or have your work displayed next to every single person in the class for comparison?
I didn't mind being next to everybody.
Yeah.
Because I felt like we were all on the same page, or one person was stronger in a certain area. There was no one that like really overpowered that in my
opinion.
At least I don't think it did.
That's fair. Because I remember, you know, thinking like, oh man, like this is the first class I ever took in my program. And it was like a freehand drawing class.
Ooh.
So, okay. So picture this. I'm going to paint you a picture. I was like, you know, I grew up being told I'm like the most artistic person in the class. And I walk into this freehand drawing class and I'm like, oh, this is going to be great. The teacher gives us our assignment, says draw something and shade it in, give texture and, you know, all of and shading, all of that. So I go home and I'm like, wow, like this is going to be so good. Like I'm definitely like not going to be the worst one. Cause let's be honest, when you have little to no confidence, you just don't want to be the worst one, right? And so I was like, okay, perfect. I'm gonna finish drawing like my dog or something, and we're gonna put it up with the rest of the class. And mine was like the worst one. It was actually like I was insanely humbled that day. It was like, oh no.
Yeah.
What did I just do to myself?
Yeah, I guess I have felt that way with hand drafting, because that's like when you're doing the perspectives and stuff.
Yes.
With perspectives, that was the hard part, because I've never done that before. I wasn't doing that in high school. So, and I think in high school when I was in art classes and stuff, I was good, but we weren't doing realistic images like that. Yeah. So I would say I'd be the same thing.
I like totally like put myself through that too. I was like, you know, I'm gonna do my dog. Like, it's just going to be such a great picture. And, you know, it's going to be so realistic. When I really should have just leaned, you know, when you try to do like a very realistic portrait, right? It's, you got it. There's no room for error, right? I really should have just leaned into the like Blue's Clues, like, you know, like the three circles and then I really should have leaned in there. But yeah, then I definitely wouldn't have passed, because it's a freehand drawing course. Can't trace.
Yeah. Oh, but, well, I see that we are running out of time, but I want to make sure we end with where people could follow you, your podcast, touch on a little bit of that. And then, yeah, just go on from there.
Amazing. Well, if, you know, my name's Taylor. If you guys want to follow me personally or business-wise, you can find me on Instagram at Taylor Eco Design. If you want like some design help, you can find me at taylorecodesign.com. But yeah, and if you want to hang out, like I don't really have a day of when I release episodes. but because I want to make sure that it's so good. But I have a podcast. It's available on Spotify and Apple Podcast. It's called It's All Perspective. And we talk a little bit about the design tips that I might have given myself back then, and a little bit of mindset, and, you know, like a little bit on the back end. So yeah, that's where you can find me.
So it's just you, it's just you on the podcast. You
have it guests. Is just me on the podcast. Yeah. Very and cool. Yeah, we'll talk about like personal stories, like, you know, my memories, maybe some traumas.
Oh, okay.
No, I'm just kidding. That's a recording. Different recording. No. Like not that kind of trauma. But yeah, just like, you know, like a trip and fall off the bus sort of traumas. Like, you know, like that. Yeah. Cool. But yeah. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, thank you. I'm glad this time around it worked out. But yes, thank you again for hopping on, and I can't wait to get this out.
Thank you so much. I look forward to seeing it. And yeah, have a wonderful rest of your day.